Hi, I'm Jeff Velotta, and I'm a thoracic surgeon here in Northern California.
Hi, my name is Nasser Hanna. I'm a medical oncologist at Indiana University.
So the first 5 years was just operating every day, pretty much, and always in the hospital. That has been the most rewarding is that when I started, even though are all 100% clinical, meaning operating, seeing patients, I was really interested in coordinating the research part of it with who I saw. I started that early too, but on the side. And so the idea with that is like, I was seeing a lot of women, for example, with lung cancer. I was seeing a lot of non-smokers with lung cancer. And I was like, what's going on here, right?
After you've done this for a while and you've borne witness to, you know, the things that you've seen and the patient's difficulties and a lot of the suffering that you've witnessed, you really do wake up thinking about how you can make a difference. When you're not at work, you try not to think about that, but that's what you do. And so how do you make a difference? Well, one way is you take care of patients. And so I take care of patients 2 days a week, do research. So I lead a number of research efforts to try to find better treatments for lung cancer. We do a tremendous amount of advocacy work. You try to prevent and screen for cancer. So there are hundreds of thousands of people in the U.S. right now who have lung cancer and don't know it. And that's because early stage lung cancer usually does not have any symptoms. And there are really only two ways that you can discover early stage lung cancer. One is if you do lung cancer screening, and the other is luck. And unfortunately, we don't get lucky very often. It's not a good strategy to follow. So stage one lung cancer usually has no symptoms. It's usually just a radiographic finding on a scan. As the cancer advances, though, you can begin to have symptoms, and I categorize them in two ways. They can be what we call local symptoms or systemic symptoms. So local symptoms are things like the tumor is irritating the airway and you cough, and maybe a tumor bleeds and you cough up blood, or maybe the tumor obstructs an airway and you get short of breath. Then there are the other more non-specific, what I call systemic symptoms. And that is just a general feeling of unwellness. You are feeling really tired. You are losing strength. You are losing your appetite. And you are losing weight that you cannot explain.
So women that are younger, and then unfortunately, a lot of them that are diagnosed later stage, stage four. Because there's no screening test for them, right? We know that lung cancer screening is covered by the government, by healthcare, by nationally Affordable Care Act, everything, but you have to be 50 to 80 and you have to be a smoking history, current smoker, or at least 20 pack year smoking history, which is a pretty significant amount of smoking history. And to make it on top, you have to quit within the past 15 years. So how many people can calculate that, figure that out? And a lot of people don't do that, especially we know epidemiologic-wise, women don't smoke as much as men, but they're more prone to getting cancer per se, but they're not getting screened because they don't qualify because all the studies were done on men.
So lung cancer screening saves lives. And if we look at all of our cancer screenings, which would be mammography, colonoscopy, pap smears, lung cancer screening is by far the easiest to do. There's no IV, you don't have to get undressed, you don't have to drink any prep, you can eat breakfast, you can take your medicines that day, you don't even have to take your shoes off. There's no poking, there's no squeezing, there's no prodding, there's no embarrassment. You literally lay down and you go through the scanner and it takes 15 seconds. Lung cancer screening is the single most effective screening modality that we have. The number of people needed to screen to save a life with a lung scan is far fewer than that of all other cancer screenings.
We have so many patients now live through stage four for years and years, which is before it was almost like everybody was dead. everybody assumed was dead in 6 months. That is totally not the case anymore. People are living way longer. That it's not a death sentence like it is before. Yes, it is still the number one cancer killer, but we've made huge strides, particularly in late stage with better drugs, targeted drugs, and biomarkers. So people are living way longer. I have patients that are alive 10 years at stage 4 lung cancer. 5 years ago, 10 years ago, you would never say that. And then earlier stage, we're doing better because we have better ways to catch it. We have more lung cancer screening. And now we're coming up with blood tests to see if you have lung cancer. So if we can catch it early, you can live a normal life.
My youngest patient was 19. She was starting her college career. I won't give out too much information because the family is still suffering pain from this more than 15 years later. Her grandmother had died of lung cancer. When she was 12 years old, she sang at her grandmother's funeral. 7 years later, she was diagnosed with lung cancer. And at the age of 21, she passed from lung cancer. You don't forget your patients. You know, I've had many, she's my youngest. I've had some in their 20s, too numerous to count in their 30s. Too numerous to count.
Hope, like 100%. And like I use it like as positivity. Surgeons tend to be a little bit more positive because we're like, well, we cut it out and that's just our thing. But even surgeons are too. Like they'll say, oh, we'll cut it out, but it's going to come back or things like that. I never use any of those words. I say, yes, there's always that possibility. Let the patient ask you. But I think the psychosocial part is so big. And patients will tell you, right? I mean, that's why I go to a lot of these meetings and listen to patients because they'll tell you, like, we don't care who you are, if you're Harvard or if you're old, young or whatever. We care if we can communicate with you. We care that, you know, you listen to us. And honestly, a lot of them care if you're positive or not.
No one deserves lung cancer. Lung cancer is unique in that it is heavily stigmatized, and patients feel guilt and they feel shame. And no one deserves lung cancer. No one, quote unquote, brought it on themselves. It's cruel and inhumane for society to have an attitude to think, well, you got lung cancer and you were a smoker, and I'm gonna think of you in this way, and oh, you have lung cancer and you never smoked, and so therefore you have my sympathies. We should feel equal sympathy for people who are victimized by this horrific disease, who suffer incredibly. People with lung cancer unfortunately bear this cruel mark. And I think it's important to advocate for them as well. Most people with lung cancer are not even currently smoking. Most people have quit. Now, having said that, there are many causes of lung cancer. 80% of Asian women with lung cancer have never smoked. In this country, over 20% of women with lung cancer have never smoked. Now, why do they get lung cancer? And why do men who've never smoked get lung cancer? Secondhand smoke can cause lung cancer. If you're in a workplace or you have a family member that you've been around for decades, you're inhaling dozens of carcinogens, and that causes cancer. Secondly, radon is the most common cause of lung cancer in non-smokers. Asbestos is an important risk factor. Working as a pipe fitter, a welder, a construction worker, in the military, and as a firefighter. Incredibly high risk populations. And then we cannot forget air pollution. Air pollution can cause lung cancer. The other major risk for lung cancer is having a first degree relative with lung cancer. So if your mother, father, brother, sister, or child, first degree relatives, has lung cancer, that greatly increases your risk. We should expand eligibility criteria for lung cancer screening because, believe it or not, and this might stun you, 50% of people diagnosed with lung cancer don't meet the screening eligibility criteria.